Sunday morning.
No problem.
Go ahead. Got a light on. We're cool. Thank you, Derek. Thank you, Derek. We enter into a time of announcements. One of the first announcements I'd like to share with you is next Sunday morning, we're going to have a time to gather together down in the fellowship hall for breakfast. Typically, throughout the history of the church, churches would gather together on the Tuesday before Ash Wednesday, and they would literally clean out their cupboards of all their various baked goods, and everybody would bake, and they'd come together for a pancake breakfast because the following day began Lent. And time of a Lent was a time of fasting. It was a time to put aside all our, if you'll pardon the expression, fat habits, and to enter into a time of contemplation and meditation on our relationship with God. This coming Sunday, the 26th, we are going to have that opportunity to gather together and celebrate our fatness and join together in food and fellowship as we begin to anticipate to enter into a time of Lent and meditation on God. On Wednesday night, the following Wednesday night, not this Wednesday, but the following Wednesday, the 1st of March, we will have a time to gather in Oxford Hall, either from 12 to 12:30 at noon to 12:30, or from 6 to 6:30 for a time of meditation and receiving of the ashes to begin our Lenten season. So those two opportunities, we're doing it that way rather than have a service. You can come in at any time during that half hour. You will be given a meditation that you can read in silence, and then you can come up and receive the ashes. Everything will be done in silence and in contemplation. There will be no music or anything like that. But that will be from 12 to 12:30 on the 1st and 6 to 6:30 that night. But this Sunday, breakfast, time of food and fellowship. Any other announcements that need to come from the congregation this morning? Yes.
Okay, this announcement's for all the women. We are going to go attend the Extraordinary Women's Conference again. A few of us went last year, and we had a lot of fun. It's October 6th through the 7th. So we have a group rate going right now, and it ends this Friday. So if you want more information about it, we would love for you to attend. You can contact myself, my mom, or Kathy for more information. And I have some little flyers if you want them today, so you can get them today, and we can help you set up your account and get your tickets by Friday for the group rate. Thanks.
Thank you, Cameron. I also want to remind you that tonight we will begin the evening Bible study of the study of Ephesians. That will be from 6:30 until 7:30. So if you have... if Sunday morning has not been your time to get here and you want to be participating in that, 6:30 to 7:30 tonight, we will meet in the conference room, room permitting. If we need to move it, we'll move it. But right now, that's where we're planning to meet tonight. And we'll continue our study of Ephesians. Any other announcements? I don't see anybody doing calisthenics to get my attention. So, let us enter into a time of worship and join together in the invocation. Almighty and merciful God, you are more loving than we truly know or understand. For you love the unlovable, care for the sinner, have compassion on those who you hate, and good to those who despise you. We are not like that. We tend to love only those who love us. and are good to those who think they deserve it. We, at the very least, avoid those we think are evil, and most often shun them out of our fear and disdain. But then we hear Jesus call us to do good to those who hurt us, and to love our enemies as though they were friends. This we just cannot do unless you put your Holy Spirit in us and guide us in this marvelous ministry of grace. Amen. Let us prepare for worship. Thank you.
Good morning. Isn't it an absolutely beautiful day outside? I just wish we had a glass ceiling on the church because it would be pretty, but we'd all be staring at it, maybe not listening. Today I brought some friends because I want to talk about all the special things that we learn when we think about God. So I'm going to ask Madison to come up and hold one of these for me. You can choose whichever one you want. This is Anne, and this is Greg. So we're just going to call them that. You know, a lot of times it's really, really, really easy to be good friends, isn't it? Because friends like to hug each other, and they like to help each other when one of them falls down, and they like to think about each other and maybe do nice things for each other. But you know what? Sometimes there's times when it's really, really hard to be nice and to think about your friend. What would happen if Greg kicked Anne? And then Anne thought about it, and that made her really mad, so she kicked him back. And then Greg said, well, I can show you, and he shoved her. And then Anne said, I can do that. So she shoved him back. And pretty soon, our friends are going like this. And you know what? That's not something that Jesus wants us to do, is it? And it's really, really hard. It's hard for kids. It's hard for grown-ups. I know that when you're driving and somebody gets in front of you when maybe they didn't signal, there's a part of you that really wants to kind of get in front of them. And that happens with grown-ups, and it happens with kids. So it's something that everybody feels inside. And that's the time when you need to really, really ask Jesus to kind of come and cuddle your heart really, really hard and help you to remember that even when something seems really, really hard and really when you want to push somebody because they pushed you, the best thing to do is to remember that maybe they didn't mean to. And even if they did, maybe they had a really, really bad day and they might need a hug or they might need a nut. That's okay. I don't mind. And that's something to think about. So all the rest of the week, if something happens and somebody bumps into you or somebody kind of pushes you or somebody says something, try really, really hard to think about what Jesus wants us to do, because I think he wants us just to love everybody, even when it's really, really hard. So let's go ahead and say a prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this family and our church, and we thank you for these children. We ask you to be with us and really hold our hearts really hard when somebody does something that makes us sad or upset or angry. Help us to remember that you came to show us that we just need to love each other, especially when it's hard. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
scripture reading this morning is from Matthew chapter 5, verses 38 through 48. You have heard it that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist one who is evil. But if anyone strikes you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if anyone would sue you and take your coat, let him have your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. Give to him who begs from you, and do not refuse him who would borrow from you. You have heard it that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you salute only your brethren, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? You, therefore, must be perfect, as your heavenly Father is perfect. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Most gracious and loving God, anoint me with your Spirit that as I speak, by your very grace and presence, O God, be the one who speaks to me. Let it be your message we hear this day, not mine. And open our hearts to receive it, that we may grow closer to you, and by your grace at work in us, closer to one another. That your kingdom may come upon this world, and it may give us all hope and guidance. For in Christ's name we ask it. Amen. Jesus, once again, begins, you've heard it said. You've heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, don't be that way. Don't be like that. Now I want you for a moment to kind of look inside yourself at how you feel when somebody does something wrong to you. When somebody does something that hurts you or hurts somebody who you care about. And then I want you to hear those words in light of how you feel. Does it make sense? Or is it more like the picture under the sermon title? And that crazy love, I'm not talking about the kind of love a lot of people like to think about it, Valentine's Day, which we just got past. But this is a crazy love that literally seems like it's insane. This love that Jesus is talking about, is he insane? Does he really expect us to do good to those who hurt us? Does he really expect us to go the second mile, to turn the other cheek? Oh, come on. And here's a good question. Do any of you know anybody that does this? Now, I grew up in a home where if somebody does something bad to you, they better run. I grew up amongst the relatives that if anybody did anything bad to us, they better move to another country. Well, we're going to hunt them down. So when I heard this as a young man coming back into the church and ready to take in what God wanted me to know and what Jesus was sharing with me, and I listened to this, And I can remember the pastor preaching on this, and he was telling us that this is the call of the gospel, and this is the call of Christianity, and this, and I'm going like, is he crazy? This is not how I grew. This is not the way I learned. This is not how it is. During that same time in my life, I began to do a lot of reading in history and social situations. I was in college and was being inundated with things much larger than my little community. And I came across this, the first slide. Here's a quote by Mahatma Gandhi. An eye for an eye makes us all blind. And suddenly I began to start to rethink this idea of a disposition of vengeance and retaliation. What does it really get us? What does it really get us? And is that what really Jesus means? Is that where he's headed with this? He wants us to stop and think about the consequences of this mentality. And then I started asking the question, where does this eye for an eye thing come from anyway? And I went back into the Old Testament, and it's, you find it back there. But I always wanted to go deeper, and I began to realize that this actually predates the Old Testament. It's, well, the next slide shows you. It's called the Lex Tele, well, let's see, I need to get around here where I can see it off this screen. Lex Talionis. It literally means a law of tit for tat. The law of tit for tat. In other words, you take my goat, I take your goat. You slap me, I slap you. You knock out a tooth, I knock out a tooth. Literally, tit for tat. Consequence for consequence. But what I didn't know was is that that law actually was an attempt on the part of an ancient culture to bring some civility to this human desire for retaliation and revenge, to put limits on it. What I began to realize as I studied it was that during the ancient cultures, literally whole villages and communities would rise up in war over a seemingly minor indiscretion, to the point where they would wipe each other out. So this law that began to become popular and well-known was actually an attempt to bring about civility. But for a moment, I want to show you something that God laid on my heart. Remember last week when I talked about human impulses, that you and I tend to be generated and guided and act upon impulses that we can't really control, that come out of nowhere, that can grab hold of us and cause us to sin? I began to wrestle with this message of Jesus. I began to realize that there's a direct relationship between how much guilt we feel to how much retaliation we want. I began to look at the church historically. And what I began to realize was that in the church, in an effort to try to create a more civilized society, the church got into the habit of preaching against sin, thinking that if we preached against sin, people would stop sinning. Well, it makes sense. Parents have been doing it for centuries. But the reality of it is that in preaching against sin, it doesn't stop sin. Have you noticed? I mean, we've been preaching against all kinds of sin for centuries. Do anybody you see a short supply of sin in the world today? In fact, from where I'm standing and watching, It seems to be getting worse. So what's the problem? I think the problem is that when Jesus was talking about those impulses and the reality of the fact that we need to be careful about being guided by our impulses, what he really wanted us to understand was is that we need to be connected to a God who understands our impulses. I told you this last week. And in being connected to God who understands our impulses, we need to understand how God deals with us in those impulses. And the church needs to understand this better than anybody. And that's when we come to the passage we heard today. Jesus suddenly shifts gears from dealing with impulses to talking about how God deals with sinful people guided by their impulses. And how does God deal with us? God goes the second mile. God turns the other cheek. In fact, God does good to those who hate him. God extends grace to those who deliberately sin against him. That's how God deals. And he does that because he wants us then to embrace grace in our dealings with one another. Let's look at the next slide. Here's the problem with grace. You and I want grace to be just and fair. And that's not what grace is. Grace is not fair. In fact, if it were fair, it wouldn't be grace, would it? Because if you and I got what was fair, we would get what we deserve, wouldn't we? How many of you, when you were growing up, would say to your parents, that's not fair, when, you know, brother or sister got something that you didn't think they deserved and you deserved more? That's not fair! In our household, that was kind of a mantra that we sort of spoke a lot. The reality of it is that God's grace isn't fair. And that's exactly what makes it grace. And he wants us to understand that grace. He wants us to embrace that grace. And here's how he wants us to do it. He wants us to, first of all, embrace it for ourselves. So then we can share it to others. Everything that Jesus is saying in these passages requires us to have a disposition and understanding of grace. Without it, you and I will simply continue to act on impulses and continue to be a people of retaliation. We will continue to be a people who want justice, not grace. And we're going to want justice the way we want it. In Romans 12, 19 through 21, Paul says this, "Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord." No. "If your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him drink. For by so doing, you will heap burning coals upon his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but rather overcome evil with good." I'm 61 years of age, and I'm still trying to learn this. Now, I know it mentally. I know it theologically. I hear the words. I understand what Paul's saying. I understand what Jesus is saying here in the fifth chapter at the end of this chapter with regard to an eye for an eye, but you know, we're supposed to do otherwise. I understand all that from a mental, theological perspective. But I need to move that 18 inches south. I need to move that from a head thing to a heart thing. I need to be able to embrace that in how I actually deal with those who bug me. Those who hurt me. Those who are not just with me. And that's one of the hardest things any of us will ever be asked to do as a Christian. Because what that's actually asking us to do is to be like Jesus. To be just like Jesus. I'm not just like Jesus. I'm just like Ron. And that's not a guy who is always understanding. And definitely not always gracious. It's hard. It's very hard. Because when you and I do things that we know are wrong and other people point it out to us, they tend to come at us and they point it out in a way that makes us feel punished, that makes us feel bad, that makes us feel the consequence of our actions. So when other people do things that we know are wrong, we want justice. You see the vicious cycle? On a subconscious level, this is how we usually come at life. Nobody gave me the forgiveness I needed. Why should I forgive them? Nobody was kind to me when I was a bad person. Why should I be kind to the bad people in my life? That's what Jesus is talking about. That's what all this is about. This, you heard it said, but I say to you. That's what it's all about. He's saying, you have somebody who is that way with you. You have somebody that is that way with you. It's God. If God really wanted to punish you for your sin, would you still be here today? I wouldn't. If God really wanted to punish you for your misdeeds and mistakes and attitudes and all those things that are not like Jesus, if God really wanted to get at you today, would you still be here? He goes on to talk about the fact that the rain falls on the just and the unjust. God does not deal with us according to our sins. God deals with us according to His grace. When I was growing up, there was one practice that my parents had, that when we were bad, we went to bed hungry. There was a time in my life there, about, I don't know, middle school, that I began to think that maybe my parents couldn't really afford to feed us, because I can remember my father complaining about the fact how much it cost to feed these five kids, because we all had appetites that could put an army to shame. And I began to think that maybe they were punishing us just so they wouldn't have to feed us. But here's the thing that interested me as I became an adult and reading these passages, is that this is exactly what God says we shouldn't do. That we should not deal with people, we should not deny people their needs because of their faults. We should not deny people their needs because of their faults. Why? Because God doesn't do that to us. God doesn't do that to us. I brought that to my father's attention. I said, Dad, do you know that this is how God, like, he said, don't preach at me, boy, don't preach at me. The simple reality is that a large part of the reason you and I have a hard time with this passage is because life doesn't act this way. This is not how it is in the world. But this is how it is with God. And that, as a church, is what we need to understand. And then we need to take that and internalize it. That, as Christians, is what we need to be and do and how we need to act with one another. If somebody's in need, we need to respond to the need regardless of the behavior, because that's how God is with us. The next slide, I think, says it very, very well. I need to get around here so I can read it. As long as I think my enemies are bad people, they will remain my enemy. The moment I choose to see them with a gospel lens is the moment I can truly love my enemies. Do you know what it means to look at somebody with a gospel lens? No. It means to look at them through the eyes of the gospel. And what is the gospel? That God loved us even when we were sinners. That when we were still sinning, Christ came to die for us. That's what it means to look at people through the gospel lens. It means to look at them through the promise of the gospel, that this is how God is with sinners. Once we start looking at people with a gospel lens, we stop looking at them according to their behavior and look at them as somebody that God loves. When I'm angry with somebody, I want God to be angry with them too. When I'm angry with somebody and I feel wrath for them, I want God's wrath to, you know, deal with them. But whenever we look at Jesus, the one thing that you and I have to come to grips with is that Jesus is the one who, when nailed to the cross, says, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." That's the gospel. And that's what it means to look at people with a gospel lens. That God sees our behavior, but God sees beyond the behavior. When I became a father, I made it my absolute vow that I would not be a father to my children the way my father was to me. In order to do that, my wife had to work with me. And there were times when, well, to be honest with you, that woman's a saint. That woman is an absolute saint. I always tell people I married up. And the reality is I did, because she has the ability, no matter how angry she gets, she never loses sight of the love she has. No matter what anybody does to her, she still keeps that vision of love toward that individual. She had to teach me that. Because when I had to deal with the boys, when they were being extremely difficult, it was hard to me to go to them and to continue to love them, because in my household, that wasn't the way it was. But my wife exampled this passage very well. And what she made me realize was, you've got to ask them, why did you do that? I just wanted to dish out the punishment. I just wanted to dish out the punishment. And tell them, you do this again, it's going to be even worse for you. That's what I wanted to do. And she said, no, you can't do that. You've got to ask them why they did that. You've got to understand their actions. You've got to understand what's going on. I said, why do I have to do that? I'm the father. I'm the guy in charge here. My rules. She said, Ron, your rules don't always work. And while we're at it, you don't always keep your own rules. You've got to find out why they did it. So as a father, I'd have to go into the room and we'd sit down and I'd say, okay, you know what you did was wrong, right? They'd nod their head. So why'd you do it? And they'd look at me and I'd say, you know why you did it. Just be honest with me. And we'd have to talk a little ways, but then eventually I began to realize that bad behavior has a reason. Bad behavior has a reason. When all you do is respond to the bad behavior and you don't understand what's behind it, what's contributing to it, what is the cause, you never have a chance to change the bad behavior. But when you get at the cause and you make the other person realize what's psychologically and emotionally and every other way going on, now you have a point of communication. Now you've got a way to talk about it. You've got a way to reason. You've got a way to reach out to this individual and treat them as the human being they really are instead of this horrible, terrible, bad person that you feel in your anger that they are. Those conversations were never easy. But you know what? As they moved into teenagers, it made the teenage years a lot easier because they knew I wasn't just going to come in and dish out the punishment, that we were going to have the conversation. And they knew that they couldn't just tell me, oh, that wasn't good enough. And once they began to realize why they did the things they did, now we had a point of communication to talk about, okay, what are you going to do in the future when this kind of thing happens again? What are you going to do? And what I suddenly discovered is that as they started through their teenage years, they didn't give us nearly as much grief as other people's teenage children did. Because they began to come to me and talk to me before the thing got out of hand. Because they knew they had a father who would listen. Yeah, he got frustrated, but he still would listen and hear them out. That's what God is trying to do with us. And that's why Jesus tells us, do not act in a spirit of retaliation. Seek rather to understand. Do not deny people their needs because you're angry at them. Seek rather to live in grace. Because ultimately, what you gain is a true spirit of community, where people feel valued, understood, and appreciated. Is it easy? No. Jesus was talking to his disciples, and he said, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, now get this, just as I have loved you. You also ought to love one another. By this, people will all know that you are my disciples if you have love one another. That's the commandment to the church. Folks, we can continue to act in a spirit of retaliation for those we feel are wrong, but all we're doing is building walls. All we're doing is eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, a sin for a sin, an indiscretion for an indiscretion. Exactly what Jane Peters was saying with the children. But that's not what we're called to do. That's not what we're called to be. In the very last phrase of that chapter, he says this, you must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. Let me see the last slide. That's what that means. You see what's happening there? You see Jesus putting the robe on the individual? If you were able to see that picture up close, you would see that the shirt that he's wearing is dirty. The shirt that that gentleman is wearing is dirty. It's not clean. And Jesus is putting his robe over him. That's how the grace of God at first works. He doesn't wait. God doesn't wait for us to get clean before he seeks to embrace us, before he seeks to reach out to us in love and compassion and understanding. God doesn't do that. Rather, what God does is God comes to us seeking rather to robe us in grace so then that he can also eventually robe us in righteousness. It's what Jesus does. church needs to do the same thing. We can address sin. We can deal with the question of sin. That's not the problem. Jesus certainly did. The problem is we can't let our conversation about sin keep us from being a community of grace. To be perfect as our Heavenly Father is perfect, folks, we are never going to be there physically. We are never going to be there in that perfect sense. But you and I can be governed by it. We can look to that. We can seek to be embraced by that. We can seek to put that on in how we reach out and deal with each other. In the religious world of Jesus' day, this was an entirely different kind of religion. It was an entirely different kind of religion. It was not a religion of judgment. It was a religion that opened the door for people to come and find forgiveness, to find hope, to find grace. We're going to move into a time of song now. And this song is first going to be done as a solo, and I want you to remain seated throughout the song. Don't stand. I know it says an asterisk because, well, that's usually what we do. But this time I want you to stay seated. And I want you to hear this song until we start through the first verse again. And then when you hear the choir come in, that's your time to come in and make this your prayer. This is a hymn of prayer that we're making to God. I want you to hear it first and let it be your prayer to God. And then I want you to literally join in when the choir starts and make it your prayer.
More like you, Jesus, more like you, fill my heart with your desire to make me more like you, more like you, Jesus, more like you. Touch my lips with holy fire and make me more like you. Lord, you are my mercy. Lord, you are my grace. All my deepest sins have forever been erased. Draw me in your presence. Lead me in your ways. I long to bring you glory in righteousness and peace. Thank you.
Most gracious and loving God, you are good to us, even when we aren't good. Your grace comes to us when what we deserve is wrath. Help us, O God, to become just such a people with those around us. Receive these gifts that they may be used to make your kingdom real through this, your church, to those who need to see it and know it. And let everything be a glory to you and an honor to your Son, Jesus Christ, in his living ministry in the world today. For in his name we ask it. Amen. Please be seated. I turn on the news sparingly, and every time I turn it on, it seems like there's just so much in it that's bad. So much that we need to be praying for. So many places where God needs to be present to. So many people God needs to help. Where would you like to call on God today to be at help?
My mother fell and broke her hip on Monday, surgery Tuesday, back to her sister living on Thursday. She's still in the hospital.
Keep her in our prayers. Thank you. Thank you, Susan.
The families of Charles Moody and Joe Garrett.
Yes.
Yes. The district youth retreat coming up next weekend.
Thank you. Definitely be praying for the leaders on that.
My grandma's struggling to walk over her knee.
Be in prayer. Thank you, Chris. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yes.
My grandma, she's doing radiation treatment.
Keep her in our prayers, and you all as well. What do you want to praise God for today?
Our government, for this country, that we would come together and try to accept the new government and move forward to make this country be who we are. We're America, and we need to try to come together.
Thank you, Beth. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. And for all of you who want snow, we don't understand your grief. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Most gracious and loving God, you are needed. You've heard the concerns here shared this morning, all the physical hurts that need your intervention. All those who are grieving the loss of a family member that need your comfort. All those dealing with circumstances in their home and among those they love that need your intervention. And yes, Lord, even our nation and government. All these things, O God, need your touch, need your presence. And we thank you that you are a God great enough for it. We know you love us, God. And we know that you want us to embrace your love with one another. And that's where the problem comes in. It's easy to care for those we love. It's not so easy for those who disagree with us, who are different from us, who threaten us and scare us. We hear your word, but we find it difficult to obey. And yet, you are still a God who comes to us. You know our needs, and you are moving to meet them even before we pray. And the sun shines down on us, and spring-like weather embraces us, whether we deserve it or not. And we give you praise. Continue to make your grace shine on us and fill our hearts, guide our thoughts and our actions so that we can be the people of your kingdom, the people of the Church of Jesus Christ. For all your people that you love. For all this we ask in accord with Christ Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father,
deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory.
There's an old saying. It goes something like this. Hurt people hurt. That's what we're seeing today. It's what we've been seeing throughout the history of humanity. Hurting people who hurt out of their own hurt. And Jesus comes to us and he declares to us, look, I understand. I understand how you are. I understand those impulses. I also understand that God is greater. Don't continue to keep being with each other out of your impulses. Out of your desire for retaliation for the hurt you feel. Don't do that anymore. Let the grace of God flow in and cleanse your heart. Enrich your soul and help you understand. So then God can go through you to a hurting world that needs him so much. Go in that grace.